Professor Mori did his PhD in Kyoto University under the supervision of a great mathematician and commutative algebraist and algebra geometry, Professor Nagata. He obtained his PhD, he graduated in 1978. Hironaka, another algebra geometer and field medalist, once wrote, "To classify algebraic varieties has always been a fundamental problem of algebra geometry, even an ultimate dream of algebra geometers." He wrote this one around the middle of the century, of the 20th century, and not much was known at that time for classification of algebraic varieties. The Italian school at the beginning of the 20th century made the first significant progress. They classified no singular projective surfaces. Their method cannot be generalized to higher dimension, and Sarisky and Kodaira made some contribution along the 20th century. Mori was awarded a few medals at the 1999 ICM in the city of Kyoto, the same city that he got the PhD. He received the medal for his remarkable work in a period of 12 years between the 1978 when he graduated and the ICM in 1990. Among the work he did is the classification of finite trifolds and the minimal model program, known also as the Mori program. Hironaka again, after the results of Professor Mori, he said the following: "The most profound and exciting development in algebra geometry during the last decade was the minimal model program. Connection with the classification of algebraic varieties of dimension 3. Mori initiated the program with a new and powerful techniques, guided general research direction with some good collaborations along the way, and finally finished up the program by himself, overcoming the last difficulty." That was Hironaka. He has received many other awards, among them in 1990, one of the AMS awards for the work he did, and several other awards. Now I'm not the one giving the talk today, so I'm going to stop here. And it's a pleasure and an honor to introduce Professor Mori.
Thank you very much, Robert. Shall I start? Yeah, thank you very much for the nice introduction. Later I'll explain how I have been doing it, and it may disappoint you that it's slightly different from the introduction, but anyway. So first, I am very much honored to be here at the 75th anniversary of this Math Institute. Well, it's not easy to achieve 75 years of history, so I'm currently officially a member of CUIAS, which is only 2 years old. And the other one, much older. So 4 years ago, we had a 50th anniversary. And I happen to be the director, so I know how difficult it is. And I couldn't do anything without the support of the older members. So I must, it must be the same with you, Jose, so I have to congratulate you all, and it was a great experience. Okay, so let me start. So I think it's the best way to show you how things were around the time, 1975, which is, well, this is just a coincidence, 75. This is the time I started my research in algebraic geometry as a research associate. And so this page is really not for you, but this is just to illustrate what are the algebraic varieties. And so it's a solution set. So first we consider the all the coordinates. The coordinates are complex numbers, are real or positive characteristic, depending on the situation. So basically, we look at a polynomial equation, and for this arithmetic operation, it doesn't matter whether the field is a real or complex or even positive characteristic. But when we draw a picture, there's some slight difference, but it's okay. Yeah, okay, so let's put it. Yeah, so classification of algebraic variety. So this is the main thing. So we want to classify, well, in this case, I just wrote one equation, but it could be a set of equations. And so this is the easiest example. So graph is birational to, or even isomorphic to the x-axis. And this is possibly the first non-trivial example. I learned this in my high school days in the for the entrance exam. Well, this is a circle centered at the origin. And from minus 1, 0, you draw a line with slope t. Then this line intersects another point, except for this minus 1, 1. And it is the coordinate is given by this formula. You can easily do that. And so this is birational coordinate change or birational transformation, whichever. So from T axis to the circle. Yeah. And so this is a typical example of a rational curve. So this means that it's a curve with a rational parameterization in one variable, like. And so here I draw a real solution, but as I said earlier, we don't really care whether we consider complex or real. Just depending on the situation, we choose the convenient one. So let's start with the dimension one. So algebraic variety, algebraic curve, it's except for finite number of points, it is embedded into one of these, the Riemann surfaces of genus G. So when G is zero, it's a Riemann surface, and G equals one a torus, and for bigger G, it's a disc-shaped donut. And, assuming that we work over complex numbers, and assuming that we put some metric. So in principle, I mean, essentially we don't consider a metric, but just for illustration, let's put metric and see how a curve is curved. Point. And in this Riemann surface case, it's positively curved all everywhere like this. And for G equals one, it's a flat. And for G bigger than one, it's like saddle shape. So for dimension one, these are the three typical geometry. And the idea is how to we want to generalize this in some way in higher dimension. But anyway, this is done in the middle of 19th century. Then algebraic surfaces. So in case of algebraic surface, there is a totally new phenomenon. Given a surface and a point P on it, we can blow up the surface in the sense that we remove a point P. By the way, I'm only considering smooth surfaces. I don't want to consider singularities at this point. So remove a smooth point, then it's a surface, so its tangent space is C2, two-dimensional vector space, a two-dimensional space. So its tangential direction is gives you P1. So we put back P1 in some way, which is called minus one curve. So given any point P on the surface, we can sort of blow up, replace P and put back P1 in a systematic way and produce another smooth surface S prime. That's what's called a blowing up. Okay? Replace P with P1, keeping the rest the same. And C is a rational curve in the sense of the previous slide. And it's called minus one curve. The reason is that if you consider the self-intersection, it's a minus one. Anyway, it's not a serious matter. And this map from upstairs, we call it the contraction. From downstairs, it's a blow up. That way. And the idea of a birational classification of surfaces is to classify them up to this blowing up or contraction. This is very much based on the minimal model programming dimension too. So this is around 1900. But in those days, minimal model had a slightly different meaning. I'll explain that later. Okay, so I'm going to explain the minimal model programming dimension too. So if X, the surface X has a minus one curve, we contract it. And since X prime is smaller, apparently, it's easier to work on X prime. So we work on X prime. And we look at X prime and see if there is any minus one curve. If there is, we contract and keep doing, and until there is no minus one curve. Well, you may wonder what if it continues for forever. But each time you contract, the second bit number drops by one, so it stops. Then when it stops, it's either P1 bundle or P2. This is the picture of P1 bundle in my mind, and P2. So these are the cases involving G equals zero, genus zero case. And this is a geometry we have in mind. And the other case is a minimal model. So this corresponds to G equals one and larger. So we don't distinguish these two cases sharply at the moment. And so in those days, the theory was very difficult. So to find minus one curve, there was a method called adjunction terminates. So case by case analysis finds you a minus one curve to contract. So it's a combination of arguments, and it's quite difficult. And so at the moment, I just present you difficulties only. Okay, so in those days, still people want to generalize this to higher dimensions. Okay. So there are examples smooth threefold with smooth surface, which looks like being contracted to a smooth curve. This is exactly the three-dimensional analog of the blow-up. And in analytic space, under certain numerical conditions, you can legitimately contract X to analytic space X prime. And so we may expect that if X is projective, so is X prime, and we can keep contracting. So there are examples where X is projective, but X prime is not projective. But you may think that we don't care about projectivity, we go on. Yeah. Then if there are examples where X is not projective, and if you contract it, X prime is no longer even algebraic. But at this point, I stop. So it's quite involved. to go in this direction, meaning looking for smaller varieties. And there are some other activities around the 60s and 70s. So this is an example by Hironaka of algebraic and birational morphism of smooth threefold to smooth threefolds, which is not a composition of this kind of standard blow-ups. Since it's fun, I'll show you in the next slide. And since in those days, minimum model program seemed impossible, and of course, at least not a very practical project. So people tried to classify the algebraic varieties without minimal models. So that's Ithaca's school. And there are people who constructed the example where smooth threefold doesn't have a smooth minimal model in any sense. That's by Ueno. So those are the examples known at that in those days. So this is the time I started working on it, and I was very curious about this, but I didn't know how to do it. And also, introduced, I came from commutative algebra. So these are the birational classification mainly worked by people in Tokyo University. Tokyo and Kyoto, though names sound similar, it's quite different. In Kyoto, people are mostly working on commutative algebra. I was one of them. Anyway, that's how things are. Okay, so this is example. So start with a smooth threefold. Just take three smooth curves, meeting at a point transversely. So this could be connected into one irreducible curve, but let's not think about it, and just three totally different curves meeting transversely at a point. And then somehow Hironaka came up with a very strange blob. In his paper, he just listed ideal. So in terms of, so start with coordinate x1, x2, x3, he exhibits ideal, some complicated ideal, and says that if you blow up, you get this way. Okay, so this one, in the middle, you get P2, and there are rational curves. Somehow, zero is red, but this is something I will do that later. Yeah. So somehow, this is not a composition of a smooth blow. One way to look at it is that if you know how a smooth blow-up looks like, it's either a P1 bundle or a P2. Exceptional divisor is either P2 or P1 bundle. In this picture, this is the only possible thing. And so, of course, we try it, we contract it, then we get the singularity. So it cannot be a composition of a standard blow up. Okay, so I'm going to explain how my curiosity grew. Okay, so possibly it's easier to show you the topics I have been interested in. The first topic is something called the Frankel conjecture or Hartung conjecture. It's about a very special variety. Apparently nothing to do with the birational classification, the general picture. Then I could prove it. And then once I proved it, I found something called extreme array, which I'll explain later. Then there are two directions, birational classification and biregular classification and the minimum level program. So this is the main topic I'm going to talk about. But you see, this is a very general problem, but somehow it started with my curiosity on a very, very special problem. Okay, so we come back to the question, how a variety is carved? Okay, so again, although we don't have to consider the metric, but to illustrate or to study how a variety is carved at a point, I introduce a metric. Okay. And then for each plane in the tangent space of a point, I can consider the geodesic along that, along a vector in this R2, and I change all directions, and the geodesics will sort of sweep out some picture like this. So in this case, it's all geodesics sort of in the same direction. So this is positive. And in this case, it goes up and go down. And this is negatively curved. And or somewhere in between. It's hard to tell. So Frankel conjecture is about this first case. Okay, so it asks, what if a variety X is positively curved everywhere for all P and all directions? And the conjecture says that there is only one such in each dimension, the projective space. Okay, so this is the precise statement. So it is about a Kähler manifold. And Hartzon sort of modeled upon this differential geometric conjecture and came up with the algebraic geometric one. So he simply replaced this positive curvature condition by ampleness of the tangent bundle. So this is where I came in. So first I considered a dimension 3, which was where the Frankel conjecture was solved by Mabuchi, and I looked at the preprint, and I became very curious as an algebraist. So I could see some way of applying derivation for studying this conjecture. So with my advisor Sumihiro and I could manage to reduce this to this Frankel conjecture. Oh, I forgot to say that this condition, differential geometric condition, is stronger than this algebraic geometric condition. So we could prove this by some extra observation on the derivation. Okay, that's how it works. But the method didn't work in higher dimensions. It worked only for dimension 3. So I had no idea how to do it in higher dimension. Okay. So that's around 75, 6 or so. Oh. Yeah, so on 79, I could somehow prove it, but I'll explain that later. Okay, so, this time I want to consider algebraic geometric measure. So earlier I talked about the differential geometric measure to check how a variety is curved. But those are not algebraic measure, algebraic invariants. So if you consider a curve C and consider all those curvature in the previous page, for all P and all planes in the tangent space, we get this intersection number up to some absolute constant. So this is a this is an invariant I want to look at. And so for sake of saving time, this is the condition I'm going to use for the minimality of the variety. So apparently it has nothing to do with the minimality of the variety in the previous slides. But later you see that how it is related. And so various positively curvedness. So the top one is the one used for the Frankel conjecture, so much stronger. And the positive ampleness of tangent bundle is weaker. And if a tangent bundle is ample, so it's determinant. So anticanonical bundle being ample is a weaker condition. And then this positively curvedness along C is a further weaker condition. Okay, so this is the condition I will use later. So I will explain a little bit about how I could solve Hartzog conjecture. So I said I could solve dimension 3 with advisor. But the method didn't generalize to higher dimension. And I didn't know how to do it. But when I was trying to prove an intermediate statement, I thought I could prove it, but there was a mistake. And when I analyzed it, in the process, I found that I somehow produced a rational curve. So this kind of statement. And once I found the rational curve, the rest is very well, it came out very easily within a week. Yeah, so it's quite it's a totally different approach. So once you have a rational curve, you can make use of it and get a statement on the variety. That's the basic attitude of my rational curves on algebraic varieties. And for some people, this was very annoying because even for such a naive characteristic zero statement, I had to go to characteristic P, positive characteristic. So when Stu and Yao proved the Frankel conjecture, Frankel conjecture, they must have tried to produce this kind of thing, but it's quite difficult, and still it's still not known how to prove this without going to characteristic P. Yeah. So if you can prove this only in characteristic zero without going to characteristic P, you may be able to do something about symplectic manifold and so on. So I was told that in dimension complex dimension 2, one can find a rational curve in symplectic category, but they use all kinds of advanced techniques, sort of minimum order program. So it's not the kind of answer I want. Okay, so so this is the statement I mentioned. And I explained just a little bit how to find a rational curve. Okay, so since Nagata's name was mentioned, I put it here. So the method is really using the notion of schemes. So this is the my favorite picture. This is the illustration you can find in the book of Manfold. So bottom is spec Z, and for each prime, you can find some geometry of characteristic P. And this is the picture of a scheme of P1 over Z. And so the basic idea is that if we are given an algebraic variety in characteristic zero, you can extend it to characteristic P. Most characteristics, except for finite number of primes. So you can work on characteristic P. And in characteristic P, you can use Frobenius, and you can somehow produce a rational curve. And once you have a rational curve, you somehow bound the degree, and you find a rational curve on almost all primes. And if you can find a rational curve of a bounded degree for almost all prime, it has to come from characteristic zero. That's a simple statement. I mean, I don't prove it, but it's quite simple. So this is something like in analysis, you don't have anything of this kind. Like we don't have any semi-algebraic setting algebraic geometry, so it's a fair deal. So outcome of rational curve. Yeah. So using this rational curve, I could prove a Hartzell conjecture, but I wanted to do something more. And so in search of the application of algebraic curves, I found the notion of extremal rays, and which gives a way to study a more general problem. So find the key structure of a variety X, which is positively curved along some curve C. Or how to find the key structure of a curve along which a variety is curved positively. So the general philosophy is that we expect that a variety is negatively curved. If it is positively curved along C, there must be some geometric reason. So that's what I'm going to explain. So I start with a Clyman's cone of curves. So X is an algebraic variety, and given a complex algebraic variety, given a curve C, we can define the algebra, its homology class of C, which is H lower to H lower to XR. So it's a finite dimensional vector space. So it's for each curve C, we have a vector. And we consider all the curve C, and we consider the cone spanned by those vectors. That's C of X. So C of X is a genuine invariant. And it looks like this. So at the moment, this doesn't mean anything, but in the next slide, I'll explain. And Clyman introduced this notion to study projectivity. And we only use one way. When X is projective and take an ample divisor, say L, then if we consider the vectors which have intersection number 1 with L, you get some bounded shape. It doesn't go through the origin. Okay, so instead of looking at the whole cone, we can cut the cone by slice, say L equals 1. So at this point, I just, how to say, I'd like to show you how I feel. Algebraic variety is something we don't see, we cannot see in dimension 4. Complex dimension 2 is real dimension 4, we cannot see. But somehow algebraic geometers, or maybe just not algebraic geometers, geometers somehow draw invariant on the canvas in their mind. So this is what I'm doing when I do research. Okay, so geometers study figures via invariants. I used to say algebraic geometers, but I try to be on the safe side. Yeah, so invariants are similar to abstract painting. There's a sharp difference. Unlike art, it needs objectivity and reproductivity. So in art, it cannot be produced in mass production. Yeah. And also, so an invariant is defined for each figure. And so here is the difference between differential geometry and algebraic geometry. So in differential geometry, they have are there differential geometers here? In differential geometry, they have a fine-tuned tools to study a shape, like this curvature and all those things. But in algebraic geometry, we don't, as I have shown. So the pictures we draw in my mind is not really concrete painting. It's rather abstract painting. And this is like a cubism. I think this is a good break for you. Yeah. And this is a picture I like. So it uses only circles and lines. And somehow it is a picture of a linen grandpa. You can somehow see, but, you know. And Paul Klee says that art does not reproduce what one can see, but makes seeable what one cannot see. Somehow this applies to algebraic geometry. Yeah. I come back to XML. So what I could find using the rational curve and the XML ray is that we look at this cone, and then on this cone, on this space, KX, a canonical divisor, works as a linear function by intersection number. And K equals 0 gives a hyperplane. Of course, it can be empty, or can be zero, or can be the whole thing. Positive is half space, and negative is also another half space. And I'm saying that on the negative side, negative half space, the cone is sort of polyhedral. It looks like this. There may be infinite number of them, so it's not really polyhedral in the genuine sense, but still it gives you the kind of feeling. So the ridge line like this, giving this, are called the extreme array. So X is a minimal model if Kx is non-negative on Cx, or equivalently if there is no extremal phase. Okay, so as an algebraic abstract painter, so this is my picture, and I draw these ones. And I want to see what the meaning of this. It's a very natural question. Yeah. A geometric meaning of extremal rays. So I come back to the surface case. So in the description slide of the extremal minimum model program for surfaces, there are a few cases. So P2 and in my earlier explanation of minimum model program, I considered minus one curve, contracting minus one curve. And if there is no more minus one curve, either I get the P2 or P1 bundle or, I assume that there is extremal ray. So there are three cases. And somehow reproducing the same picture in the minimum model program in the earlier case. And the difference, so there is a difference. The difference is that this time we know where to look and where to look the minus one curve and the structures. And it gives a much simpler proof. And it works when there is a group action. If there is a group action, extremal ray is defined as the edge of a very natural object. The group acts. If there is a group action on the X, it acts on the cone. Yeah. So one can use extremal rays to do a higher dimension. But to do that, we immediately have problems. So it's a singularity. So we contract something, we may have a singularity. And so around the time I introduced extremal ray, Alice Reed also found this new class of singularities. So imitating a case of a surface, I can consider a threefold and apply minimum model program. Meaning, if there is an extremal ray, I do something. And in Hironaka's example, I showed you that there is a P2 whose contraction gives you a singularity. That's exactly this case. If you start minimum model program, sorry, I haven't really explained what minimum model program is, but in a few moments I will. Then I will get a singularity, and to continue the program, I also have to find a framework which contains variety with singularities. Yeah. So if we create a theory of cones with such a singularity, then I may still get the last singularity. And then I include it and work on it, and I may still get the last singularity. But Miles Reed found just the right class of singularity, which works for the MMP. And then Kawamata, Reed, Shokurov, Benveniste, those people constructed a general framework. And so this is the description of extremal ray. So you should compare this with a two-dimensional case. So in two-dimensional case, either P2 or a P1 bundle. In dimension three, it can be sent to a point, a curve, or a surface. Okay. So these are the natural generalizations. And generalization of minus one curve is a divisorial contraction. So So a divisor is either contracted, so the surface is either contracted to a curve or a point. And in this case, the singularity downstairs is still very good. It may be singular, but it's something one can handle. It's a, if we start with terminal singularity threefold, then the bottom remains terminal. But then, unlike the surface case, there is a very tricky case where only a curve, a finite number of curves, is contracted to one point, to a point. And in this case, no divisors are contracted. And you may think that it's not too bad, but actually, the singularity downstairs is very bad. And basically, we want to measure things by the intersection number of curve and the canonical divisor. And in this singularity, canonical divisor is not a, something one can compute intersection number with curve. So we cannot do this. Okay, so in this case, we need something something different, something new in dimension three. So suppose this is the situation: small contraction, minus k, and pull. Oh, this is something automatic if you start with the extreme array. Then, from this, you get another one. So it's like removing the curve and put back another curve in a different way. And then for this variety, canonical divisor is ample, relatively ample, although this one, minus k is ample. It's totally different, quite opposite. So this is like a surgery in topology. Okay, so this generalizes in higher dimension. So the theorem is that clips do exist. So I managed to prove it for dimension three, only for dimension three, 1998. Hakon and McCannon proved it for all dimensions about 20 years later. So this was based on Shokurov's philosophy. So Shokurov proposed various ways, and it was very difficult, and the people tried to understand Shokurov's philosophy and hold many conferences. And this was really a great achievement out of it. But, so, flip exists. But then what's next? Yeah. So, if you start with, okay, so here. The minimum number program is the following. We start with the algebraic variety and ask if there is an extreme array. If there is not, it's a minimal model by definition. If there is an extreme array, there are a few cases, either divisor contraction or some global structure or flipping small contraction. In case of small contraction, since the singularity becomes bad, we replace by its flip, then we can continue the program. Okay, so it says repeat divisor contraction and flip as long as it can. And so if it terminates, we get a minimal model or a final, just like a case of surface. So termination of the flip is really the central question. And in case of dimension three, there's a Shokurov's result. Although he used the classification of the terminal singularities, he constructed a very sharp invariant, numerical invariant, out of which one can immediately see the termination, flip terminates in dimension three. But in higher dimension, it becomes extremely difficult and still open. And currently, the cutting edge result is this. A particular kind of MMP, well, MMP with scaling. So it terminates in most cases in all dimensions. I don't explain in what most cases. And so this is a result by Birka, Cassini, Haycon, and McCannan. So Haycon and McCannan proved this existence of flips. And so those four people together somehow managed to prove the termination for a special kind of minimal model program. So which is still enough for many applications. So because of that, since it works in all dimensions, in many cases, minimal model program is now a very fundamental tool to study algebraic varieties. But as I wrote here, for technically precise exposition, I have to introduce a boundary and a log version, but I didn't want to do it. So let's review. So in dimension two, so if I have a minus one Kabay contract, and if I have another minus one Kabay contract, and keep doing it, and if there is no more minus one Kab, I have either P2 or P1 bundle or minimal model. So in dimension three case, there are three new ingredients, minimal array and a singularity and new operation flip. And now it works in all dimensions. Okay, so let's review how the difficulties I presented at the beginning remains. Okay, so this is the same slide. Okay. So there was an example when I produced by good looking contraction, I produced a non-projective variety. So what's wrong with that? Well, so you made the wrong choice of contraction. There is a extreme array along which you can contract and get a projective variety. You may get a singularity, but you can keep projectivity. Okay. So X remains projective as long as you contract extreme array. So Hironaka's example was not decomposable into standard blobs. So in terms of minimal model, sort of relative minimal model program shows you that every birational morphism is a composition of divisorial contraction and flips. And classification of algebraic variety without minimal models, so it's Itaka's theory. So he came up with several conjectures. And now those conjectures, Itaka's problems, are studied using MMP. And the bottom, minimal model can have terminal singularities. Okay, so this is Hironaka's example. So as I said, we have to contract this. So it's a divisorial contraction. And if we contract this, there are only three curves above the origin. And actually, it's symmetric. And no matter what to do, no matter which to choose, no difference. I just pick up this one. So the only thing, only conceivable thing you can do is flip. If I do the flip, it looks like this. And then this is, this can be contracted to a smooth curve. And this one too. And then you can contract it. And you obtain this one. So this is how birational morphism can be decomposed. But I have to admit that it's not a very fair statement, because flip is not a morphism. But nevertheless, this is the best we can come up with. Okay. Thank you very much.
Are there any questions, comments, doubts?
Okay, so it's for positive characteristics, the only result known is for dimension three for minimum level program. For big genus, for big prime, I think five is okay, but I forgot. Two and three are not settled yet. But for higher characteristic, there is a theory of minimum level program. Basically the same picture. Sorry? I should have expected that question from you. Because we discussed about the real ones. Yeah, so it's something I mentioned in the talk. Since external ray or the cone is a natural invariant, if the group acts on X, the variety, it acts on the cone, and also on the invariant space. Suppose in your case, we start with the real algebraic variety. We go to complex one, complexification, and then on the complexification, we construct a cone, and we consider the invariant subspace by the conjugation. Yeah? Then you get some slide of a cone. And what the extreme array of this cut? Well, it's the same as it will not be an extreme array, but it will be an extreme phase. You know, you can guess what it means. Eh? And by studying extreme phase, you can study the contraction of the real algebraic variety, and you can basically do the same argument. Yeah, it can be contracted to another real algebraic variety, but may have a singularity. You know, the complex may have a singularity. Oh yes, this is all relative actually. For simplicity, I just consider the abstract case. So I mentioned Hironaka's case. That's really a relative one. So you can set up the relative case, and that's actually easier. Yeah. So no problem.
Yes, you made a very careful statement that made me very curious. So you said that a particular case of MMP with scale works for most cases, which means you leave open a possibility that other types of MMP, and then what in the world is with scaling, and in the cases that that one does not work, what are people doing then about this that in the most cases? So,
to explain this special kind of MMP, MMP with scaling, I should have introduced the cone of divisors. Not the curve. So I can't tell you, but so in the dual setup, this MMP with scaling is just going to k straight. it cannot go anyway. So at the level of a cone of at the level of extreme at the level of cone of curves, MMP with scaling automatically chooses you the extreme array to work on.
It works on most cases.
Well, so there are still people working on it.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
Any more questions?
Working on it, but there are people working on it. What do you mean? Could you make it explicit? What?
Right.
Constructive. Well, it's more abstract, yeah. So it gives you a line bundle. It gives you a linear system by which you get a contraction morphism. That's okay. Sorry, I can't give you the precise.
Okay, I think we should thank Professor Mori again.